Good morning, everyone, and welcome to morning worship and prayer. Today, we'll be reading about the story of Judah, one of Jacob's sons. In fact, allow me to read from Genesis 29, verse 35, when he was born. It says there, "And she conceived again," talking about Leah, Jacob's wife, "and bore a son and said, 'This time I will praise the Lord.'" You see, there's always reason to praise God in your life. I pray that as we come to Him this morning, you'll be able to find one. Let's go ahead and praise the Lord together. That God, we praise your name all over again. Grateful to you, Lord, for how faithful you've been to our lives, how you've been at work, Lord, in our circumstances, in our families. And we're praising you all over again in Jesus' name. Amen. And as we go into our devotional this morning, you know, Christmas is almost upon us, and we're excited to be able to explore the different promises that God gave that would eventually bring forth the miracle called Christmas. And today, we're specifically reading from Genesis 49 in verse 10, where it talks about Jacob, now on the tail end of his life, giving a blessing to each of his sons. Now remember, Jacob had 12 sons. And at this point, in Genesis 49 in verse 10, he's giving a blessing to his fourth child, namely Judah. It says there, "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until tribute comes to him, and to him shall be the obedience of the peoples." Judah, interestingly, is the fourth child, and yet the rulership has been given to him. Well, you know, his older brothers had a bit of situations. You've got Reuben, and then after that you get Simeon, and then Levi. All of them had situations that because of that, they were in a sense disqualified. But then when it came to Judah, the Lord gave him grace. And you know, the way it was before, when the patriarch, the parent, the father specifically, would give a blessing to the children, it's almost like he's being led by God to be able to speak into the future of his kids. And when Jacob was led by God to be able to speak into the life of Judah, he talked about kingship, or rulership rather. "The scepter shall not depart from Judah," referring to him and the generations that would come from him, "nor the ruler's staff from between his feet." It says there, "until tribute comes to him." The idea that the nations would bring tribute to Judah, or that as Judah would rule over Israel, over the nation of Israel, that the nations will bring tribute to Israel. "And to him shall be the obedience of the peoples," meaning that the nations surrounding will, in a sense, obey or be respect, or at least be able to see the example of Israel. Or if it would come to the point that Israel would also rule even the surrounding nations. Now, this was a promise given by the father, Jacob, to Judah, his fourth son. And as he was saying that, you'd begin to wonder, would it actually be fulfilled? Would that promise actually come to pass? Or would that blessing actually come to pass? Apparently, we know now in retrospect that that blessing came from God because, as we shall see in history, that would indeed come to pass. Let's follow the rest of the story. This particular passage in Genesis 49, verse 10, when Jacob was blessing his sons, is most probably set around 1800 plus BC. Now, as the nation of Israel would grow, eventually they would ask for a king. And the first king that they would have would be Saul of Benjamin. Benjamin would be the tribe from which Saul would come from. The whole promise of the scepter not departing from Judah has not yet happened. But the next king after Saul would be David. David would be coming from the line of Judah. And then, because David had a heart toward God, he was a man after God's heart, eventually he would desire to be able to build a house for God. And God was, in a sense, pleased, you know, with that desire that David had, such that he gave a promise. "David, you're not going to be the one to build my house for me because your hands, you know, have shed blood. But it will be your son who will be able to build it. But it was good for you to have it in your heart to build a house for me. And because of that, because you wanted to build me a house, I will build your tent." Now, in their days, that word tent meant their family line, their lineage, their descendants. So God gave a promise to David in fulfillment of the blessing that was given to Judah more than 800 years earlier. God would now give a promise to David saying, "Because your heart was toward me, I will build your line, your lineage. I will build for you a tent, a family line, and you will never fail to have a king in the throne coming from your line." Now, as we follow the rest of the story, for the next centuries that would come, they would experience, you know, turning away from God. Eventually, after David, now I know we're talking a bit of history here, but don't worry, there's a point to this. After David came Solomon, after Solomon came Rehoboam, but Solomon's son Rehoboam was not a good leader, such that eventually the kingdom was torn from him. And then the whole nation was divided into two. The northern kingdom, which would continue to take the name of Israel and would be comprised of 10 tribes. And then the southern kingdom, which would be composed of Judah and Benjamin, but Benjamin would just be little in population, such that that whole nation would eventually be called Judah. And Judah would be ruled by David's descendants. And there would be several of them that would be righteous, you know, along the way. But then in the end, they would also turn away from God as a nation, such that the Lord would now send Babylon. This was around 586 BC. So you see that? Around five centuries, or less than five centuries, after David ruled the nation of Israel, less than five centuries later, Judah, the southern kingdom, would be ravaged by Babylon. They would be sent there as exiles. And for the next 400 plus years, they would not be hearing much from God. And then you'd already wonder, Lord, what happened to the blessing that Jacob gave to Judah? What happened to the promise that God gave to David about him not failing to have a son on the throne of Israel? Well, Christmas time is the fulfillment of that promise. When Jesus would eventually be born, and we'll read his genealogy in Matthew chapter 1. This is a wonderful account. In Matthew chapter 1, it will talk about verse 1, the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. So just saying in that one verse, being the son of David, being the son of Abraham, meaning that Jesus would be in the line of Judah, because David would be a son of Judah in that sense. Jump to verse 16, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. So even though Joseph was just a human father, you know, to Jesus, or rather a human husband to Mary, and yet the Bible would trace the lineage of Joseph being part of the lineage of David, and then being part of the tribe of Judah that would eventually be ascribed to Jesus himself, him being the Lion of Judah. And in Jesus would be fulfilled the promise that was given, the blessing that was given to Judah, the promise that was given to David, that Jesus' reign would be eternal, and that would continue on for generations. In fact, another prophecy that was given by Isaiah would describe this for us in a wonderful way. Isaiah 9, verse 7, which would say, of the increase of his government and peace, and of peace, referring to the servant, referring to the Messiah, referring to Jesus, there will be no end, but because Jesus would be an eternal king. On the throne of David, take note of that, on the throne of David, coming from the line of Judah, and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness, the fulfillment of the promise both to Judah and then to David, from this time forth and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. A few implications coming from this story. God gave a blessing through Jacob to Judah around 1,800 plus BC. Then it would be fulfilled when David would rise to the throne around 1010 BC. And then God would give a promise to David that he will not fail to have a man coming from his line. And that would be fulfilled around between 0 to 5 BC, depending on the timeline, when Jesus would be born. And now Jesus reigns, rules and reigns, and has fulfilled that blessing and that promise. Let me tell you this now. You see, the Lord also has a blessing and a promise for every single one of us, now that we have come under the rulership of Jesus himself. And every single promise that you've also received from God as you read scripture in your own prayer time, the Lord's blessing and his promise, they endure. The Lord's blessing and his promise, the same way it was given to Judah and to David, they also apply in our lives today, that the blessing and the promises that God gave to us is something that he will fulfill. In fact, it says there in the latter part of Isaiah 9, verse 7, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The Lord is able to fulfill with his strength, with his zeal, with his passion, with his resolve, with his purpose, with his will. Every blessing and every promise that has been given to us, it shall be fulfilled. And Christmas is proof of that. I pray that you may continue to trust God for every blessing and promise that he has given you. That in the same way that many of these blessings and promises have been given in the past and the Lord fulfilled in Christmas, so will he fulfill in your life. You see, Jesus fulfills the promise to Judah And Jesus continues to rule over the nations. And we're believing that the same fulfillment of every blessing and promise that God has given, that He will also do the same to you and to your family. Let me pray with you now. Lord, I ask you that you would stir up faith in our hearts, that Christmas is a representation of the fulfillment of your blessing and your promise, and we receive this from you today again. Oh Lord, we're grateful, for we did not, Lord, you gave us grace, that you would graciously give us your blessing and your promises. And so today we trust in you again, and we receive your blessing and your promise for each of our families, for our individual lives, and for everything, Lord, for everything that surrounds us. Thank you, Lord, for your favor and grace showered on us, especially in this Christmas season. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's go ahead and worship God again.
Peaceful my suffering, joyful my weeping, life is beginning now. Your grace with no failing, your love never ending, forever we sing it loud. Peaceful my suffering, joyful my weeping, your life is beginning now. Your grace never failing, your love with no ending, forever we sing it loud. Sing a new song to our God, for in Him we have overcome. Raise the anthem of our love, hallelujah, our hope has come. Sing a new song to our God, for in Him we have overcome. Raise the anthem of our love, hallelujah, our hope has come.
And so, Lord, we thank you because you are faithful always. And today we revel in your blessing and promise, and we receive it again by faith today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord turn His face toward you and grant you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Lord bless us, everyone, and good morning.